everyone.
It's lovely to see you. Happy Mother's Day to the mums and ladies of the church. And it's lovely to see one or two new faces. So may the Lord bless you. So today we are looking at the subject of worship. I'll make a mum's paper. And worship really covers everything about our relationship with God. Ty Woke preached brilliantly about 3 or 4 weeks ago on the subject of joy. Reggie spoke a couple of weeks ago about praise. Actually, I can't remember where I am. He spoke about praise. And Reggie spoke about joy. And those things are part of worship. So we will be pulling all these strands together in today's service, which is an all-age service. So we'll be looking at some passages from Scripture and acting them out, which are all about worship. So let us pray as we come to worship. Father God, we come before you now, and we want to acknowledge that you are here and that you deserve our worship. Father, we come to present ourselves to you as loving children, as servants of Almighty God. Accept our worship, Lord, this day. Amen. So, the first thing we're going to think about worship is that we worship God because he's actually worthy. He's worthy of worship. You wouldn't worship what you wouldn't sort of think of somebody who was a pain in the neck as somebody you want to worship. There's got to be a reason for why you worship God, or some people worship football stars or pop idols. There has to be a reason. And this first hymn gives us plenty of reasons why we should worship the Lord our God, all people that on earth do dwell. Thank you. Amen.
Thank you.
I should have said as well at the outset that our minister, who is back now and well, it's his birthday. It was his birthday last week. So he's having a birthday weekend and doing all sorts of nice things. Okay, so as we have just sung, praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, all creatures here below. Why? The Lord our God is good. His mercy is forever sure. Approach him with joy. It is the right thing to do. And that is just what we're going to do in our first reading. When Happy is going to come and read us a psalm.
Great are the works of the Lord, they are pondered by all who delight in them. Glorious and majestic in his deeds, and his righteousness endures forever. He has caused his wonders to be remembered. The Lord is gracious and compassionate. He provides food for those who fear him. He remembers his covenant forever. He has shown his people the power of his works, giving them the lands of other nations. The works of his hands are faithful and just. All his precepts are trustworthy. They are established forever and ever, enacted in the faithfulness and uprightness. He provided redemption for his people. He ordained his covenant forever. Holy and awesome is his name. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. For who follow his precepts have good understanding. To him belongs eternal praise. Psalm 1:11.
Thank you very much, Happy. Continuing in that vein, we have Leanne, who is going to come and sing for us a song called Hosanna, which is a Hebrew word for praise the Lord. So I hope we've got Leanne. Okay, Leanne, thank you very much.
So I don't know where I read or heard this, but I think it was in this church. Hosanna actually in Hebrew means save us or deliver us. But in today's Christian context, we use it as praise because that's how we associate the word Hosanna when Jesus came into Jerusalem. That sort of thing. I chose this song. This is actually the first song I sang in this church. I thought it was appropriate for this service, and it talks about. It encompasses the two meanings of save us and praise the Lord, as well as I think it's also a prayer in this time and age. See you.
it said everything that you need to say about the power of worship. We worship God because he's our Savior. It's as simple as that. He has given us a place in heaven. He has given us forgiveness of sins. And he helps us every day. He gives us grace to live in this world. So thank you very much, Leanne. Powerful song. So now is the time of church notices. And if I've forgotten anything, please do wave at me. So there is no church lunch this month, just in case anybody was wondering. Chris, where's Chris?
Outside,
right. She has jams for sale. Now, Chrissy's jams are the best you can get. And so it's for St. Luke's, which is our local hospice. So if you feel able during coffee, do go and buy some jam and other odd bits and things. It's raising money for St. Luke's, and I promise you her jams are the most delicious ever. And the last notice, another notice next week about deacons' elections. We're running up to nearly the end of the time to vote. Your church members, your voting slips are outside on the table with your name on it. If you haven't taken it, please do. Vote for whoever you feel, and the box is over there as you go out. So just remember, you've got this week, next week, and the AGM, which is a week on Wednesday, will be your last possible chance to vote. Okay? And it's supposed to be for you next week, but due to all sorts of unforeseen circumstances and all the Easter services that time as well, we're not actually going to have it for you this month. I'm away the last 2 weeks visiting my daughter in the States as well, so it's just getting too much at the minute. So there will be no for you this month, but there will next month. So any other church notices you think I might have forgotten? No. Right, so we're going to look at our first Bible story. And this is a Bible story about one of the minor prophets. And his name is Habakkuk. So, I will set the scene in just one moment when I will find Habakkuk. Right, Habakkuk. So, I need Caleb to come and be the prophet. Habakkuk, thank you. Would you like to stand there? This young man, right, is a very regal figure in Israel. This was 2,500 years ago, around the time of Jeremiah, the Babylonian exile. Now, he was in a very difficult time in Israel's history because there was a marauding army from Chaldea. Now I have organised a marauding army. Please, would the marauding army come out? Now they were planning that they were going to destroy Israel. Okay, so I need you to sit on front row, please, marauding army. I've got you in place now. So there was from Chaldea. Now a little bit of background. So Israel had been doing everything wrong. They'd gone after foreign gods, they'd married people, women from other lands. Oh, it was hopeless. And God was trying to get their attention, like he does us sometimes. You there. You know, you're not following my way, and you are going to hurt yourself. Because if we follow God's way, we are safe. Even though sometimes we should feel very unsafe, but nevertheless, we are safe. If we follow the world's way, chances are we will end up in a real mess. We'll have a marauding army chasing us, whether it be fear or guilt or whatever. And the prophet Habakkuk was preaching to the people that God would bring retribution. Because you're not listening, you're not turning back to me, said the Lord. So, a little bit about Habakkuk. As I say, he was almost like a king. The prophets were at those times in Israel. And he had lots of servants. So now I need Happy. Please, would you come and be chief servant? Okay. You are the head and show the head servant. Okay, and under you, you have Ori and Kenny, and you've got Wikir. Could you come and help too? Would you be happy to help? You don't have to. Okay, can I have Brian and Myra? And I don't know, the little lad there would like to come and help us. He wants to come and be a servant. You go look after him, Happy. Do you want to come and join us? Would you like to come and do a bit of acting? I mean, bring your little sister. But up to you. Maybe if you hold her hand, you can join. Happy will hold your hands because she's really, really good because she knows exactly what to do with servants. Right, okay. Now then, these servants would be presented by the head servant, and they would all come and bow before the prophet, who was a bit like a king, because he had the words of God, and that was all anybody bothered about. We bothered more about what God said today, be a much happier world. But he listened to what God said. So each servant in turn, you are going to bring the gifts of the people. And we'll see a little bit about Habakkuk. So each servant in turn, can you bow before the prophet Habakkuk? And then can you go over and see the stores master, stores mistress, who is Frankie, and get your gift, please, to give to the prophet. Okay, so you've got to bow and go over to Frankie. So, hey, you forgot to bow to the boss. Thank you. Right, come on then. Well done. Well, that was a very good bow. My, oh, well. Actually, that's a definition of worship. Before Almighty God. Right. Okay, young man, what's your name?
Jordan.
Jordan, can you come and bow? And then can you go over there with the other children? I think that lady is in worship, which is great. Okay. You can bow.
I'll bow.
That's it, can you bow? Yeah, right. You go and see. Can you come to this little Jordan? He's a new servant, he's got to learn the ropes. That's it, right. Well, worship is supposed to leave you a bit more joyous, but you did very well demonstrating exactly what the Hebrew meaning of worship is, which is to lie prostrate before mighty God because he deserves it, because he is maker, creator, and saviour. Right, now the first thing is that the chief servant brought great, beautiful robes. Happy? Or Jordan, can you bring beautiful robes, please, for our prophet? Well, thank you. So these were beautiful robes, as we can do, for Habakkuk. And he would have been greatly respected. And then he had amazing food stuff brought in. All gifts. Wow. So he had olives. Olives. If you'd like to present them, I'll put them on the stage, please. Would you like to just put them down? Thank you. And we had beautiful fruits. Thank you. Apples. And we had money. People would give money for whatever was the equivalent to money. Sorry, it's only play money, don't fear. And also, he would have had an awful lot of knowledge. So he would have had books, he would have had scholars, he would have had disciples who would have followed him and just hung on his every word. So he'd have had big books in today's world. Come on then. Thank you very much, Kenny. This is the Oxford Bible Companion. The sort of thing you need if you're going to be a prophet. Right, okay, so he was in a really good job. Everybody thought he was brilliant because he brought the word of the Lord. Really, really important. But then God said, no. Israel, yeah, Habakkuk's fine. He's bringing the word of the Lord. He's saying, repent, change your ways because you are not following me. So it got so bad that God told Habakkuk that he would bring the Chaldean nation, my marauding army. Now these were particularly scary, and all the stories about how they acted were going around Israel. Now, they weren't just your ordinary army. They used to line up a village. They would go into a village. They would line up a village, and they would take maybe two or three men, women, children, and they would torture and kill them in order to say, we're boss. If you dare disobey us, then we will destroy anyone who puts a foot wrong or says a wrong thing. And this is how, I'm going to read you, how suddenly Habakkuk felt. He heard the messengers that they were coming to get Israel because of what they had done. And he said, I hear all of this. I hear that the Chaldeans are coming, and I tremble. My lips quiver with fear. My body goes limp, and my feet stumble beneath me. I will quietly wait for the time to come when God will punish those who attack us as well. Right, Chaldean army, can you stand up and look sort of like scary? And then can each of you come and steal his goods? Because they took everything, absolutely everything. Can you come and steal this one, please? And you're looking absolutely terrified. Can you look a bit more terrified? Like, yeah, that's right, okay, you've done good. Okay, right, marauding army, you can all sit down again for a minute. And this is what the prophet Habakkuk said when the Chaldean army had come into his village and taken everything that people owned. He said, even though the fig trees have no fruit and no grapes grow on the vines, even though the olive crop fails and the fields produce no corn, even though the sheep all die and the cattle stalls are empty, he was pronouncing the truth. Everything had gone, everything had been taken. But then he said something about worship. Worship doesn't always depend on what we have. Worship depends on the fact that God is for us. When everything else is against us, God is for us. And this is what he said. The prophet Habakkuk said, I will still be joyful and glad. I will still worship because the Lord God is my Saviour. Hosanna. The Lord will give me strength. He makes me sure-footed as a deer, and he keeps me safe on the mountains. So he was acknowledging that everything was black, that there was this awful enemy against God's people, and yet God was still with him, therefore he would worship. We worship in bad times, we worship in good times. And Habakkuk, I don't know what the end of the story is, I haven't read that far, but I do know that he found peace. And when we're up against it, when everything seems to be against us, nevertheless, God is still God. He is still our Father. He still says, cast all your cares on me, for I care. Thank you very much. Habakkuk, can I be sure back now? Thank you very much, young actors. I need some of the rewarding army, but at the end, so you can go back to sit where you want. So actually, it's the Goody Army coming in at the end. So thank you very much to my Marauding Army as well. So I think we now need to sing. And by the way, the Hebrew definition is exactly what little Tiny down there was doing. She was lying flat on her face, well, almost, before God. And that's what the Hebrew word means, to bow down, to lie prostrate, because God is so great. We put him in a box. We have no idea how much he loves us. Thing is, we don't always understand what he's doing. We don't go by what we see. We go by what we know, what scripture tells us. So, let us sing. Now you can join in. Here I am to worship. Thank you. Thank you.
Brian and Moira, please.
And I'm going to ask them to take a plate of goodies, thanks to Andrew. And if you can pass them out to all the ladies. So, Ori, can you take that plate, please, and do the quarter by the door? Kemi, could you do the bit in the middle on that side? Moira, could you do the bit that side in the middle, but to the left? And can you do over by the organ, please? Brian, thank you. And I've asked Young Ian just to play while you take it.
Their faith with us. We pray compassionate compassionate God for those mothers who have been hurt. And disillusioned or disappointed in their role as mothers. We pray for those who have been hurt and led in long for chance and motherhood, and for those whose years for mothering have been cut short for after the loss of a child. And we live before you, O God, at the memories of our human family around the world, and for those who are afflicted or suffering at this time, and for those who need healing, and for those who require bread or shelter, and for those who live in violent homes and crises, and for those who are grieving, and for those whose need are known to you alone. Holy Mother and Father of us all, touch us with your healing, peace, and gentle embrace. And as we walk in your ways, bringing dignity, justice, and peace to all corners of the world. All of this we pray in the strong name of Jesus. Amen.
Thank you, Ori. Well done. Okay, so I asked Taiwo to find me a piece of music to which the children, and the grown-ups if they would like, could dance, because that is part of worship. David danced before the Lord. Worship can come in many, many different forms. This is when we're praising God. And actually, we want to say thank you for our mums. And she found a brilliant song in honour of mothers. So we are going to play that now. And I wonder if the young people, or anybody who would like to, any child who would like to come and join us, we've made some praise banners. God's banner over us is love. So anybody who would like to come and wave some banners, it's quite a slow song, so you don't have to bop from foot to foot too much. If anybody would like to come and join us out in front, if you've got some extras for their praise banners. I mean, Jordan, as mom or Miss Al, you're welcome to come and join us. If you want to come and sort of jump, come fit us up. I think maybe we'll ask Jordan if he would like to hold a banner. And his little sister, if she would like to come. I'm sure with a bit of help from Dad, we might manage it. A bit of help from Chris. We praise the Lord through music. We praise the Lord through dance. So, okay, if you want to join in, it's not really a clappy thing, but if you want to stand up and sort of sway from foot to foot, please do. Okay, thank you.
Anything more than that I could be, and it just wouldn't feel right. Yeah, I didn't.
love that. And I think the two youngest members of our congregation today, I think God's specially smiled. I think it's wonderful. Thank you for coming today. We couldn't have done it without you. Wow. So they can keep on waving. I'm sure the Lord would like praise more than just 5 minutes during the hymn. Okay. Now, for you is a group of people who meet for Bible study after church once a month. And dear old Franklin, she takes the kids and she does lots of interesting things with them. And what she did last time, it just looks amazing. She's going to come and talk a little bit about what she did.
Yeah.
Children for making such a beautiful card, which will go hopefully on the notice board so everybody can see after the service. Now we're going to have a testimony of what worship involves a little bit, and Taiwo is going to come and give us a testimony from her life.
Morning, church. Happy Mother's Day to us, to all the women in the house. I'm going to be sharing, my life is abundant with testimonies, but I'm going to be sharing a testimony of a mother's journey and worship with God. And a couple of years ago, what started as a normal day, and me going to visit my in-laws with my brother-in-law and the children alongside with us, ended up a day of tragedy. So we had gone up to my brother-in-law's house to spend the day. And because I was going to share a story, another story today, but because of the hymn that we shared, because of the story that Lynn had shared, that was why I'm sharing this testimony. Oh, no. I want to start it as a normal day, you know, gathering of families had almost ended up in a tragedy. And we had gone up to my brother-in-law's house, and in the course of the children playing, my daughter had fallen into the pool, and she was brought out of the pool dead. And when they brought her out of the pool, my first instinct was to panic, as every mother should or would want to panic. But I had spent that week, because by the unction of the Holy Spirit, I spent that week praying a lot, and I began to declare the word of God, which Lynn had spoken about here, you know, the Bible. And I began to declare the word of God concerning her. You know, she was already blue, there was no life in her again. And as I was declaring the word of God, my husband had been doing the CPR and had stood there declaring the word of God for about 20 to 30 minutes. And all of a sudden we saw life in her again. So they had picked her up at that point and they had taken her to the hospital. And that was where the journey really began. When we got to the hospital, all her organs had shut down. And they had brought in two specialist consultants who had thought that the best, the man had thought that the best thing he was going to do was to jumpstart her organs, was to give her some antibiotics that they only give to horses. They're like tranquilizers. And the woman was like, no, you can't do that to this. She was, at that time, she was 4 years old. And so the journey started in the hospital. They had to transfer us to a bigger hospital with better facilities. But to cut the long story short, every time they came with a diagnosis, oh, there was nothing they could do. I would tell them, no, this is not what the word of God says to me. I was very stubborn in my faith because I knew what God would say. I would spend the time, she was in the ICU, get to the world, all chewed up. And I remember a particular Saturday, they had tried everything they could and they said nothing was working. And they wanted to intubate her. And I looked at the doctor, I said, we're not going to do this. And I would spend the whole day in the hospital, go back home at night. As I was crying, I would be dancing. I would dance for hours. You know, when Lynn was sharing that scripture in Habakkuk 3:19, that scripture was one of the scriptures that got me going. Though I don't see anything, I see you, promise. And I would come back to the hospital the next day, and they would tell me, oh, there's been a slight improvement. But what took a turn of events was there was a particular day the consultants had all come together with the nurses, the matrons, everyone, because they were reviewing her case. And they said, wow, there was nothing more they could do for her. Because the machine that was supposed to be what she had swollen up, you know, and she wasn't expelling the water. Her body was swollen. You know, and I remember the consultant, he said, that there was a machine that they were going to use, but it was all the way in China. And they had called China, and China had said that they cannot bring that machine down until the month after. Mind you, we had already spent almost 3 weeks in the hospital, and no respite. And that day I just got up. There was a faith in me that just rose. And I looked at the matron looked at me, and the matron just said, you know what, we have been deliberating about this young child for too long. Let her mother go and attend to her, and let's see what will happen. And I got to where her bed was. She was totally out of it, gone. And one thing that helped was every night before I left the ICU, I would put communion in her mouth. Whether she was absorbing it or not, and I would speak the word of God. And I went to the bedside where she was, totally out of it, gone, nothing. Her organs were shut down solely. And I said, God, I said, the Bible says you are worthy, O Lord, to receive praise and honor. And everything you have created is for your pleasure. As I feed this child with this communion, the spirit that raises Christ from the dead will quicken and revitalize her mouth. And I put the communion in her mouth. And the hymn, Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Mind you, it was the ICU, only six people. I had watched two people die while we were there. a young boy of about 11 and an older man. And another man was already on his way to death. So the whole place smelled. And I sat down and I kept singing that hymn, "Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise God from whom all blessings flow." The next minute, one of the nurses came in to check on her stats and just screamed. Oh, her pressure was going up, you know. And I looked and I got up to where she was saturating air at 20% to 95. And I just burst into tears. So I left the ICU that night, and the specialist doctor said, he said something. He said, if she saturates less than 90, they're going to have to put her in intubation. And he said, left the hospital, I started dancing again. I told God, I said, God, you put her at 95%, because normal air saturation is 95. Anything below 90 is a problem. I said, you put her there at 95, you keep her there. I went home because no one is allowed to stay in the ICU. I went home that night and just kept dancing and praising God. But I didn't see her in the hospital bed anymore. I saw her. By the time I got back to the hospital the next day, a child that was not debating life was dead. The next thing they told us, that day, we moved from the ICU straight back into the ward. And we had spent 3 weeks in the hospital, almost 4 weeks, so she couldn't walk. You know, and they said, oh, they needed another therapist to come and rehabilitate her walking. That night in the hospital, just she and I in the room together. And I would get out and I would speak the word of God and I would play the music. And I'd tell her, Kemi, walk to the toilet. She would fall down. Pick her up again and they walk. By the next morning, she had started walking again. So they told us, oh, we had to wait till Monday or Tuesday so that they could discharge her from the hospital after running some tests. And on the Tuesday, they had run, they had come, we used to do body tests for her every day, take her blood, run all kinds of tests. So on the Tuesday, they had run the normal tests that they were supposed to run. And they said, oh, that there was one more thing that they needed, you know, that it seemed like she hasn't fully come out of it. And I was like, what God has started is going to finish, you know. And by the end of that day, after spending 4 weeks in ICU and a couple of days in the ward, she was discharged fit to go. And when they had the last review, you know, the specialist, the doctors, I said something that was quite interesting. One of the doctors burst into tears and they asked him why. He said, when this child was brought into the hospital, when we had our first review, what we said to ourselves was, this child is already dead. We're only going to manage her and she won't die. But this child has become miracle. The whole hospital heard about this child. In fact, so many people heard about this child. And it was just the beauty of what God was doing in that time. Because she was brought in lifeless and she left the hospital walking on her two legs until today. Kemi is 11 years old, 7 years after, she's so strong. Kemi doesn't fall ill. If everyone around her is falling ill, she doesn't. Even at a point in time, my whole house, we all had COVID. She didn't get it. God has shown himself very faithful in his act of worship. And as I leave this pulpit, I will speak back that scripture in Revelation 4:11. It says, thou art worthy, O Lord, to receive strength and honor. For thou you have created all things, and all things will be made for your pleasure.
Not always that easy.
Easy?
The hardest thing Tyro ever did. God did the most amazing miracle. Sometimes it looks like he's not there. He's not going to do a miracle. Sometimes he does. He knows. He's sovereign. He understands. Whatever he does is righteous. It's good. And it's because he loves us. Sometimes it's a fight. And I'm going to ask Chris and Erica, if they were born, but it was just Chris. He's going to come and sing a song called The Fight, because sometimes Christianity is a fight. How does worship fit into that? Thank
you all. We fight. Everyone fights for something. And to fight for being able to ask for forgiveness for instance. You do something, fight you something again against someone. It's a fight, probably. In my heart, in my mind, to be able to go to ask for forgiveness, whatever I could do.
The time when a man did right.
That was absolutely lovely. And it makes the point that Taiwo had to fight for Kemi's life. She didn't know what the outcome would be, but she fought and she kept on fighting. And sometimes you don't get a miracle at the end of it, but you have fought and God has walked with you. And sometimes the end is yet to be seen, but God walks with you. He promises that. He walks through the valley of the shadow of death with us, as Psalm 23 tells us. So sometimes it's a fight. And Jesus had to go through a fight. He had to go through Calvary because he loves us. And it says an awful lot about how we worship God. This beautiful song, "When I Survey the Wondrous Cross," look at the words, because they tell how God gave his life, how he had to fight for the life of the world, and how we too will take Jesus' example in our worship of God. Thank you, Yunmin. Jehoshaphat and all the people lay before God and said, "What do we do? Will you help us?" And God said, "Appoint an army." He's going to have the army back. Where's the marauding army? You are now the army of the people of God, appointed by God to fight. Could you come up here, please? Okay. appointed by God. So I need you to go and train over there, please. Okay, yeah? You go train over there. Right. Okay, go train over there. So he trained the army. And then God said something very strange. He said, I want you to appoint singers. So can I have, let's say, Kenny and Ori, Kieran, Moira, are you coming out or are you too tired? What's the idea? I don't know if Happy and Caleb would come and join us. And we still got Jordan. Anyway, so could you come and join me, please? They were appointed singers. And this was their anointing. This was God saying, you have beautiful voices, use them in my service. Forgive me, I think I might be one short. You don't mind. Right, come up here. And they practiced singing. Now the title is, you sure you won't be in the choir? We have a music group, we have lots of people who sing and play, and that's great. But the armies of Moab and Ammon and Seir were getting nearer and nearer. The army was really good. They were ready to fight. Mind you, they were a bit scared, didn't they? But God said, no. Send out the choir first in front of the army, and they will sing praise to God. They will talk about the beauty of the holiness of God. They will talk about how his mercy and his loving kindness endures forever. They will sing worship songs. And you know, this choir, the gates of Jerusalem were opened, all the enemies were outside. The choir were brave enough to go and stand outside, and they sang to the Lord. They sang worship. I think they were all shaking in their boots, but they sang worship. And you know, God defeated the whole of the armies. Won't go into how it's getting on, but he did. He defeated all of the armies. And Israel that day won the day. Thanks. Not to the expertise of the army, and they were brilliant, but to the worship of God by the choir. Thank you. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen, and children. Okay, thank you. And that is one of the other things about worship. It is powerful. We read the story of Habakkuk where he could praise God no matter what. Even if it looked like it was a total disaster, he still worshipped God. And it looked like it was a total disaster in that story, but God turned it round and defeated the enemies. And whatever situation you're in, whether it's good or bad, praise God. Worship him. Worship him with what you do for him. Worship him through singing, through dance, through reading the word of God, through prayer. Whatever you do, worship God. For it will always bring good results. Maybe not the ones you expect, but it will bring the presence of God into your life. And that is worth it. So I'm now going to ask, please, if Anne-Marie, Femi and Brian would come and do the intercessory prayers. Thank you.
Yesterday, we pull our thoughts and worries and hopes into the hands of God. We place into the hand of God the life of this church, the people around us, and those who are not here today. Place into the hands of God our difficulties and our frustrations, and our hopes and our worries about the future. We place into the hand of God the life of this church in all the world. All the people in the world who bring God's love to others, all the people who are in danger, should they share God's love.
Loving God, let your best us make
us a blessing to your world. Lord, in your mercy. We praise into the hands of God for all that needs peace, all that needs wisdom, all that needs healing. We place into the hands of God the leaders of every nation, the poor of our own, and every land, those who live in fear, and all who hold the lives of others in their hands. Loving God, you have poured such love into the world. Show us how to help make it a more loving place. We place into the hand of God our families, our friends and our neighbours, those who live and work in our towns, in our shops and local businesses, those who work from home, those who are unemployed and poor who pass through on their travels. We place into the hands of God all those we know who are suffering. Bless them with your love and comfort the healing and show us how to care for them. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer in the name of Christ. Amen.
I would just like to say, I think the kids have worked so hard today. Please, would the children come and help themselves to one of those at the end of the service, okay? Because I think you've worked very, very hard today. Right, the offering is now going to be taken. Thank you. As you stand before God, offer him anew your life. That is worship. Offer him everything you are, everything you do, your time, your thoughts, your words, and your deeds. Let us pray. Were the whole realm of nature mine, that was an offering far too small. Love, so amazing, so divine, demands my soul, my life. We sing our final hymn, As the Deer Pants for the Water.
As the deer pants for the water.
Service, may he commission you anew. Lord, we love you. We want to worship you and to serve you in this coming week. Thank you for all your blessings to us. In the name of Christ we go. In his name we go. Amen.
Thanks for being here. time left.
I expect you to be away.